Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Electronic Devices and Circuits Lecture 17. Hopefully you are all doing great and continuously revising the concepts that I covered in the lectures from lectures 1 to 16. If you haven't gone through the past lectures, it's my advice to go through them first and then hop on to this lecture 17. Hopefully you are also basically solving multiple questions, multiple numerical problems and multiple theoretical problems based on the concepts that you covered in the past 16 lectures. If you haven't gone through, first go through them and then hop on to this particular lecture. I'm a course instructor, Utkarsh Upadhyay. Okay, so let's begin. So if you really like the video, hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below in the comment section. And also refer these videos to your friends who are in need of quality education, who are also preparing for the GATE exam, GATE 2019 or IES or PSUs or IIT M.Tech interviews. Okay, so we basically terminated our last lecture with an introduction to the junction capacitance, where I basically briefed you about the junction capacitance, what actually is it, and on what parameters does the junction capacitance depend on. Okay, so and what should be the order of the junction capacitance? It should be as small as possible because we do not want any sort of disturbance in the circuitry, in the devices. We don't want any sort of disturbance in that. It should be as small as possible. So we basically started off with that, and there are basically two types of junction capacitance. First one is when the diode is reverse biased, and when the diode is forward biased. Okay, so when the diode is in reverse biasing, when diode is reverse biased, the capacitance that occurs at the junction is known as the transition capacitance. So let's begin our lecture with the discussion of the transition capacitance, which we represent with a symbol CT, and that's basically a transition capacitance. Okay, it's these basic concepts are basically very, very simple, but yet important. So I would have advised you, I would suggest you to please remember these concepts, because recently in the GATE 2018, a question has popped up as a numerical answer type question based on this particular concept, based on the transition capacitance. Okay, I would basically solve that question later once I basically finish these two topics. The transition capacitance and the next one is the diffusion capacitance. Then I will solve that question. This is also very important. You just need to know what the orientation of the capacitance and the forward resistance of the diode. That's the main key. So let's begin our lecture with that. Okay, the transition capacitance is also known as the depletion layer capacitance, the space charge capacitance. It's also called as depletion capacitance or you can say a space charge capacitance. There's some analogies. Okay, the second one is CT is a junction capacitance when it is reverse biasmos. It's basically a junction capacitance when operated in reverse biasing. Okay, capacitance is basically defined as the rate of change of charge with respect to the voltage. That's a common definition. That's a basically a second level of sixth class definition, 10th class definition of a capacitance. So capacitance is basically equal to dq by dt. It's a rate of change of charge with respect to rate of change of charge. Okay, so what does it signify in this semiconductor case? So with the change in reverse bias voltage, with the change in reverse bias voltage, W changes, your width changes. Okay, that's what we know. We increase the reverse biasing, your the depletion width increases, changes, and so the immobile ions or charges in the depletion region. Okay, in the depletion region, the rate of change of immobile ions with respect to the change in reverse bias voltage is what is referred to as a transition capacitance, is your CT. The CT is basically your CJ, junction capacitance, which is epsilon A upon W, farads. That's quite tacit. Now, we know that depletion width when the diode is operated in the reverse biasing is basically 2 epsilon by Q, 1 by Na plus 1 by Nd into mod VO plus V reverse bias voltage. This is what we know. So we know that W is proportional to the square root of V naught plus VRB. And as we know that transition capacitance is inversely proportional to W, okay, so we can say that transition capacitance is inversely proportional to square root of VO plus mod VRB. Okay, as you can say from here, this implies that CT, as VRB, let's say VRB is very, very greater than VO, is quite a large value. So transition capacitance is quite a large value. So CT will be proportional to square root of VRB. So we can say CT is proportional to V to the power minus 1 by 2. So from here it is clear that CT will be proportional to V to the power minus 2. But that's basically for a step graded diode, when the diode is step graded or abrupt junction. So if we have to if there are multiple type of devices like your linear graded diode or the diffused PN junction diode, then this exponential parameter, the exponential power, will change. So let's discuss in general what your transition capacitance, how your transition capacitance depends on the applied voltage, reverse bias voltage. So in a reverse bias diode, the transition capacitance CT is proportional to V to the power minus N. Do remember this particular relation, because this is important, where N is basically your graded coefficient, where N is a graded coefficient. Okay, when the diode is step graded or the abrupt PN junction, abrupt PN junction means when the doping concentrations are very, very high, then CT will proportional to V to the power minus half, which implies that N is equal to half. When the diode is linear graded, which is basically a linear PN junction, the CT is proportional to V to the power minus 1 by 3. This implies that N is basically equal to 1 by 3. And when we discuss about the IC diodes, when we consider when the diode is basically your diffused PN junction, so CT is proportional to V to the power minus 1 by 2.5. This implies that N is equal to 1 upon 2.5. So that's basically this one is not in the syllabus. So you can forget it. But these two are important. Okay. So most of the questions will basically circle around the step graded PN junction. Unless specified, you don't need to consider N is 1 by 3 or 1 by 2.5. By default, if nothing is mentioned, you need to take it as 1 by 2. That's it. That's my advice. Unless mentioned, do not take it. So N will be taken as 1 by 2 by default, unless mentioned in the question. Okay. So if we just have a look at these two cases where we discuss about the step graded, how your equations would look like, where n is equal to half, your w will be equal to square root of 2 epsilon by q into 1 by na plus 1 by nd. That's basically mod v naught plus vrb when it is operated in the reverse biasing, or in general v naught when it is in equilibrium or isolated. And when we consider the linear graded diode, so n is basically 1 by 3, and I must also mention that ct will be proportional to v to the power minus half. N is equal to 1 by 3, your width will be equal to the cube root of 2 epsilon by q, 1 by na plus 1 by nd into mod vo plus mod vrb. That's what you need to understand, where ct proportional to minus v to the power minus 1 by 3. That's quite tacit from what we already discussed. So for better performance, as I already mentioned, for better performance, CT should be as small as possible. So these basically are the parasitics which basically show its significance when we operate the device at higher frequencies or the lower frequencies. Diffusion capacitances are larger, so they are significant at the lower frequencies. Transition capacitances are basically smaller in a magnitude as compared to the diffusion capacitance, so they become significant at the higher frequencies. So we basically do not want these parasitics to occur if we want the diode to operate smoothly or seamlessly. So better performance, CT should be as small as possible. Okay, so CT is basically equal to 3 picofarad, is equal to 3 picofarad for BJT, and is equal to 5 picofarad for diode. Okay, so this property CT is used in designing of vector diodes that we shall discuss about later. Okay, now the second type of parasitic capacitance that basically show its significance is the diffusion capacitance when the diode is operated in the forward biasing mode. So the second one is basically your CD, which we represented with CD. CD is diffusion capacitance or the storage capacitance. Okay, so this parasitic show its significance when the diode is operated in the forward biasing is basically nothing but, so when the diode is operating in the forward biasing mode, there will be the flow of the majority charge carriers across the junction. That is basically the majority charge holes from the P side to N side, and electrons from the N side to the P side. That rate of change of the majority charge carriers is what referred to as the diffusion capacitance, and that's basically correspond to the applied forward biasing voltage across the terminals of the PN junction diode. Okay, so let's write some points based on this. So it is the junction capacitance when diode is operated in forward biasing. Okay, so there will be a flow of charge carriers this is a PN junction, this is PN, and this is basically the applied certain voltage, which is plus minus VD applied here, and the holes will basically move in this direction. Electrons will basically move from N side to P side. This is electrons, this is holes. Okay, so with the change in forward biasing voltage injected majority charge carriers, majority for the for so you can write minority charge carriers because the, this is basically with respect to the so this is basically with respect to the part that part in which the charge carriers are injected. So that's why we are calling it, calling them injected minority charge carriers, because electrons will basically be a minority charge carriers for the p type, and holes will be minority charge carriers for the n type. Okay, so minority charge so in this case minority charge carriers change. So this rate, this rate of change of minority charge carriers at the edge of depletion region is what referred to as diffusion capacitance, which is CD. So CD is nothing but CJ is epsilon A upon W, and we can say that CD is proportional to the area of the junction, and CD is inversely proportional to the width of the depletion region. Your W is basically proportional to the square root of the square root of the inverse of doping concentration. So we can say as we can see that W is inversely proportional to the doping concentration. So this implies that CD will be proportional to the doping concentration. Okay, CD will basically increase with increase in the doping concentration on either side of the junction. Okay, so CD, diffusion capacitance, is always greater in magnitude than the transition capacitance. CD is basically nearly equal to 100 picofarad for typical value for the BJT. That's basically a typical value. And for the better functioning, this diffusion capacitance should be as small as possible. Okay, so for better performance, for better performance of BJT, CD should be as small as possible. Okay, so let's dive deep into the concepts related to the diffusion capacitance. CD is basically equal to tau G. Tau is basically the carrier lifetime of the charge carriers. So in this case, let's say we just talk about the Abbott PN junction diode. Let's say we consider the P plus N junction. So NA, which implies that your NA is far greater than ND. Okay, so it's way greater than ND. So diffusion capacitance will be equal to tau into G. G, I will write the, I will basically explain these two terms here. So tau, for in this case we will consider tau as tau p, because holes will be dominating in this case, because the diffusion will be more prominent of holes as compared to the electrons. So if we consider, let's say n, if we consider p n plus, which means that your nd is far greater than na, so in this case tau will be considered as tau n. If p plus of n plus junction is considered, which means that NA and ND are both comparable, so we can take any of the two. We can take either tau N or tau P. Tau N or tau P. This is some basic concept. You can just keep that thing in mind. G is basically referred to as dynamic conductance. Dynamic conductance is basically becomes comes into picture when the diode is operated in the when the AC voltage is applied across the diode. So I already told you that there are two types of capacitances. First one is forward resistance, which is basically when the diode is operated in the operated with the external DC biasing, and your small r, which is 1/G, or the dynamic conductance or dynamic reactance resistance come into picture when the AC biasing is applied across the diode. So G is basically equal to 1/r. So we used to represent RF as the forward resistance when operated in the DC biasing. When DC biasing is applied, and small r when it is operated with AC biasing. Okay, this is operated when we apply an AC biasing across it. R is basically your dynamic resistance. Okay, it's a dynamic resistance. So where R is basically equal to eta VT by IF. Okay, where VT is the thermal voltage. It's a thermal voltage, and eta is nothing but the same value which we just had a discussion on. Eta is basically a graded coefficient. Okay, make a correction here. Eta here is basically your recombination factor. Which is basically 2 for silicon and 1 for germanium. And IF is a DC forward current across the diode. Okay, so CD will be equal to, since it is equal to tau G, so, and tau is basically your carrier lifetime. Okay, it's a carrier lifetime. So tau G will be equal to tau by small r, and as we know, R is eta VT by IF, so we can write it as eta VT IF, and we know that IF is equal to IS, approximately equal to, when this exponential term is very large as compared to 1, is e to the power VD by eta VT. So this implies that CD will be equal to tau by eta VT, IF is IS, e to the power VD by eta VT. So this will be the overall expression. So diffusion capacitance comes out to be equal to tau IS e to the power VD by eta VT by eta VT. So this is your diffusion capacitance. So as we can see that CD basically depends upon, is proportional to tau, and CD is proportional to IF. So as your forward current increases, your diffusion capacitance increases, because that's basically the rate of change, rate of flow of charge across the junction will also increase correspondingly. And diffusion capacitance also proportional to tau. Larger the value of tau, larger the capacitance is. So where tau is basically carrier lifetime, it's basically carrier lifetime or the lifetime of the injected minority carriers, or you can, in other words, you can say it's basically a lifetime of injected minority charge carriers. By the way, your forward current is nothing but drift current that basically occurs due to the drifting of the injected minority charge carriers or the majority charge carriers from N side or P side across the junction. That's what it was referred to as a diffusion of the charge carriers as soon as they basically enter into the opposite region. Now, by rearranging the equation, we can say that tau, which is the charge carrier's lifetime, is equal to CD by G, which is equal to CD into R, and R we know is CD eta VT by IF. With this, if we know all the other parameters, we can easily find out the value of carrier lifetime. This is in seconds. Okay. As I already told you that if you have that P plus N junction, your N is greater than ND, so tau will be considered tau P. If P plus N, your tau will be considered tau N, and P plus N plus when we tau will be considered tau N or tau P. This is what you need to remember. That's all basics. Now, next comes the derivation, the derivation of the transition capacitance. What basically it boils down to, there is a basic simplified expression for that. Let's derive that. So that's basically a derivation of transition capacitance. Was that equal to, what does it boil down to? Let's just quickly have a look at that. Okay, so as we know from the basic definition, CT CJ is epsilon A upon W. So it's when we operate the diode in the reverse biasing. So where W we know is 2 epsilon by Q, 1 by NA plus 1 by ND to mod VO plus mod VRB. Okay, now let's further solve this thing. Let's plug this expression into the transition capacitance expression. The CT will be equal to CJ is epsilon A upon square root of 2 epsilon by Q, 1 by NA plus 1 by ND VO plus VRB. You have to take the magnitude values of these two voltages. So if we just divide the whole the numerator and denominator with epsilon, so dividing numerator and denominator by epsilon, we get CT as CJ is A upon square root of 2 upon Q epsilon, 1 by NA plus 1 by ND into VO plus. Just keep in mind that I'm not going to continuously write the magnitude of these two voltages. It's quite tacit. I'm just writing simple VO and VRB. So by default, you need to consider that I'm writing the magnitude values. Okay, so transition capacitance will be equal to, if we just solve the denominator part, we get it as 2 upon Q epsilon, it will be equal to NA plus ND upon NA ND VO. We just take the V naught out of this particular expression, and if we just take this thing up, we get transition capacitance as A square root of 2 epsilon, it will be equal to Q epsilon by 2 V naught NA ND by NA plus ND upon square root of 1 plus VRB by VO. So if VRB is equal to 0 when no biasing is applied, when we haven't applied any biasing, the CJ will be equal to CJ naught. Okay, so that's basically a value of junction capacitance when reverse bias voltage is 0. This will be equal to CT will be equal to CJ naught, and that will be equal to A square root of Q epsilon by 2 V naught NA ND by NA plus ND. Okay, that's basically one thing to have a look at. Okay, CJ naught can be expressed in farad per meter square. This is in CJ naught, that's basically in farads. This will be in farads. So we let CJ naught can be expressed in farads per meter square. Then CJ naught will be equal to, because if we divide by area, we get farads per meter square, will be equal to Q epsilon by 2 V naught NA ND by NA plus ND. okay, this will be in farad per meter square. So your transition capacitance, overall transition capacitance, will be equal to CJ naught divided by square root of 1 plus VRB by VO. This will be in farads, or you can just write it as farad per meter square. This is important expression, and a question based on this particular concept popped up in GATE 2018 that we shall also discuss a few minutes later. So one more way, in order to explain related concept, let's just write in another way. It will be equal to 1 plus VRB by V naught. It will be equal to 1 by 2. So in general CT is equal to CJ naught divided by 1 plus VRB by VO to the power of M. M is nothing but your graded coefficient. M is will be equal to half for step graded diode. For step graded diode will be equal to 1 by 3 for linear graded diode, and will be equal to 1.25 for your diffuse p-n junction. Remember one thing, your diffusion capacitance, when the diode is operated in the forward biasing, thus diffusion capacitance basically, and if the diode is considered to be non-ideal, the diffusion capacitance basically occurs in parallel combination with the forward resistance. Just keep that thing in mind, okay? This is a diffusion capacitance and this is the forward resistance when operated in the forward biasing mode. This is VD, and we are not considering any cut-in voltage across it, okay? This will be this is basically the parallel combination of CD and RF. This is when forward biasing is applied. When the reverse biasing is considered, the transition capacitance, which is CT, will come in parallel with your reverse resistance, which is RR, okay? When the reverse resistance, which is VRB, okay? So parallel combination of CT and RR. So based on this particular concept, a question popped up in the GATE 2018 examination. If you basically mistake this combination to a series combination of RF and capacitance CD, your answer would be wrong. It is wrong. This is not correct. It's always a parallel combination. Okay? Okay, let's consider an example. For example, let's say we are given Na as 10 to the power 17 atoms per centimeter cube, and let's say you are given Nd as 10 to the power 16 atoms per centimeter cube. Okay, so your temperature is given as 300 Kelvin, and we need to find out the CT naught. What is your CT naught? So let's say CT naught will be equal to CJ naught, is nothing but by default we are considering the abrupt p-n junction, and we know that CT naught is equal to Q epsilon Na Nd by 2 V naught into Na plus Nd. This expression that we just derived, plug in the values. You have to take all the magnitude values, 10 to the power minus 19 epsilon, since we are considering a silicon, the relative permittivity is 11.7 into 8.85. Be careful, do take care of the units. It should be of the same order, 10 to the power minus 14, okay, farads per centimeter square into 10 to the power 17 into 10 to the power 16 divided by 2 into V naught. V naught will be 0.782728. We can find by V naught by VT ln Na Nd by Ni square. It is 10 to the power 16 plus 10 to the power 17. If you solve this, you get it as 0.804 into 10 to the power minus 10. okay, the CJ naught. And if we need to find, if we are required to find out, let's say CJ, so will be equal to CJ naught divided by 1 plus square root or VRB by V naught. Okay, this will be equal to 8.04 into 10 power minus 10 upon square root of 1 plus. Let's say reverse bias voltage is, let's say 0.728. This will boil down to 0.416 nanofarad. This is CJ. Okay, hopefully this example is clear to you. Now let's have a look at the gate question, which basically gate 2018 question based on this, based on these concepts. Okay, let's have a look at this example, which is which was asked in gate 2018 EC examination, which is basically a numerical answer type question. A DC current of 26 microampere flows through the circuit shown. A diode in the circuit is forward biased and has an ideality factor of 1. Okay. So it's quite, from these two points, ideality factor being 1 and in forward current being in microampere, it's, that's quite tacit from here. It's a germanium diode, because it's a germanium diode. So let's say ideality factor of 1 at the quiescent point, which is basically DC operating point. The diode has a junction capacitance of 0.5 nanofarad. Its neutral region resistance can be neglected. Assume that the room temperature thermal equivalent voltage is 26 millivolt. For omega equal to 2 into 10 to the power 6 radians per second, the amplitude of the small signal component of the diode current in microamperes, correct up to 1 decibel places is what? So this is basically a diode. So we basically are provided with the eta is equal to 1, which is basically your utility factor, okay? Or you can say it's a recombination factor. It's basically a recombination factor. Recombination of the utility factor, both are the same. Utility factor. Okay. Or you can say it's an ideality factor. All three are same. So, just want to make one correction here. This representation of the diode is basically in the, when it is operated in the AC biasing. So there is no, that's my apologies, this, there is no equivalent representation when it is operated in the reverse biasing. So just neglect this thing. This is not what I wanted to teach. I wrote it by mistake. So that's basically your reverse, this is basically your RR, which is basically AC resistance of the diode. Okay, now let's have a look at that. So we need to find out, so what are we asked to find out? When assume that the room temperature thermal equivalent voltage is 26 millivolt, at this frequency, the amplitude of the small signal component of the diode current in microampere, correct up to 1 decibel place, is what? Okay, let's try to find out. We need to find out the amplitude. First of all, let's represent the circuit with its equivalent circuit. So we can represent, when you perform the AC analysis, we basically neglect the DC component, so we make it zero. We only consider the AC, while performing the AC analysis, we only consider the AC component. This is 5 sine omega t millivolt. Okay, as I already told you that the diode will be a series, will be a parallel combination of the diffusion capacitance and the resistance RD. This is basically your RR. This is your diffusion capacitance CD. This is basically your diffusion capacitance CD. There is a 100 ohm resistance connected here, and this is how it will look. Okay, so that voltage is with the help of the DC parameters that we are available with, we can find out these values. We can find out the values of diffusion capacitance and RR. Okay, so diffusion capacitance is nothing but tau G. Okay, and we know that R is basically your eta VT by IF. Okay, so eta is 1, in this case a recombination factor or the identity factor, into VT is 26 into 10 to the power minus 3 divided by IF. IF is 26 into 10 to the power, because 26 microampere minus 6 So RR, your AC resistance comes out to be equal to 10 to the power 3 ohm, which is 1 kilo ohm. Now, when we perform the ISRO, we know this thing. Now, let's try to find out. And we also know diffusion capacitance is 0.5 nanofarad. That's what we already, that's already mentioned, this value is already mentioned in the question. So now let's say the current I, small I, is basically AC current is flowing in this direction. So while applying the KVL, we get I as, so I as 5 sine omega t. This, remember, this thing is in millivolt, this is in millivolt, divided by Z equivalent, equivalent impedance. So we can say that Z equivalent will be equal to CD in parallel with the, so this there will be a, we'll consider the reactance, capacitive reactance in parallel with RR plus 100. So this will be equal to RR in parallel with 1 by SCD, this is the diffusion capacitance, plus 100. As in this case we are going to consider, so we are considering the phase as well. Okay, we are going to consider the phase as well, which is basically 1 plus j omega CD. Okay, this plus 100. So Z equivalent, on rearranging these equations, we get RR divided by j omega CD divided by 1 plus j omega RR CD into j omega CD plus 100. Okay, so if you further solve it, you get Z equivalent as RR upon 1 plus j omega RR into CD plus 100. Now plug in the values, we get, on plugging in the values, we get Z equivalent as RR is 10 to the power 3 ohms, which is 1000, plus 1 plus J omega. Omega in this case is 2 into 10 to the power 6 radians per second into 10 to the power 3 into, what is CD? 0.5 into 10 to the power minus 9 farad plus 100. So Z equivalent comes out to be equal to 1000 divided by 1 plus j plus 100. If you solve it further you get 1100 plus j 100 divided by 1 plus j. It's quite a big problem. It's basically incorporates a hell lot of calculations. Okay, so we can write it in the Euler's form. Okay, we can write it in Euler's form. This will be equal to 1100 square plus 100 square upon square root of 1 plus 1. And the phase will be equal to tan inverse of 100 divided by 1100 minus tan inverse 1. So use the calculator, the gate calculator, judiciously. Okay. By using the calculator, if we solve it further, if we basically solve these magnitude expressions and the phase expressions, so we get 781.02 phase is minus 3 degree. Okay, so this is the net impedance across the potential, the AC voltage, AC signal voltage. So I will be equal to 5 sine omega t millivolt divided by 781.02 angle minus 3 degree, which is in ohms. So if you solve it further, you get I as 6.401 sine omega t plus 3 degree. This is in milliampere. Sorry, this will basically come out to be in microampere. Okay, so I will be equal to 6.401 sine omega t plus degree microampere. So hence we can conclude the amplitude of small signal current is 6.401 microampere. So the answer would be 6.4 or 6.401. Correct up to first decimal place, so it will be 6.4 is the answer. Okay, that's all folks, I'm stopping this lecture here. This lecture was quite interesting because in this I basically explained you different type of capacitances that we can basically see, that they are basically parasitic capacitances which basically come at variable frequencies and how do they affect the device functioning. So we want them to be as small as possible. Okay, we saw some great examples based on these concepts. Now you can see that the question has already popped up in the GATE exit 2018 examination, so please try to remember these concepts. Thank you very much, and do write down your comments below in the comment section if you have any doubt. We'll get back to you with the solutions. Thank you very much.